Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second installment in our Inside the Creative Process series. We're very happy that you could join us. While we have people continuing to sign in, I'm going to just go through a few housekeeping items. Please be sure you're using Google Chrome, Microsoft Edge, or Mozilla Firefox, as our webinar platform doesn't support Internet Explorer. All of the windows in front of you can be adjusted for size and location, so if you want to take a minute just to experiment, you can use your cursor to move all of the windows and make any of them larger or smaller. Please don't hesitate to reach out if you need help or you have questions. Click on the help or question and answer chat feature. If you need any assistance, we have people standing by to assist. Finally, for the duration of our presentation, we're going to be in listen-only mode, but we strongly encourage you to ask questions throughout the program. We've already received some questions, but the format today will be that Lar and I are going to be speaking, and then we're going to be lucky enough throughout the program to be watching three different clips of Lar's dances. So it would be especially interesting if you submit questions that you have about the actual dances, which I realize you couldn't submit ahead of time. So with those housekeeping items behind us, I am very pleased, it's my great honor and pleasure to have Lar Lubovitch with us today. And I have been lucky enough to be on Lar's board for more years than I would necessarily care to mention, but it has been over 25 years, which is amazing. I want to tell you, before I formally introduce Lar to you, I want to give a brief biography of Lar. His many accomplishments are far too detailed to go into here, but I want to give a brief overview just to set the stage for introducing Lar and for you to have some background on his works. Lar trained at the Juilliard School, and he founded the Lar Lubovitch Dance Company in New York City in 1968. So that's been, I know you'll find it hard to believe looking at Lar, but it's been over 51 years ago. And in those 51 years, the company has gained an international reputation as one of America's top dance companies. Lar's dances have been performed by many major dance companies throughout the world. Othello, which we're going to see as our was created in collaboration with the American Ballet Theater and San Francisco Ballet. And it was featured on PBS's Great Performances, for which it won an Emmy nomination. Lars also created dances for film and television, including Fandango, My Funny Valentine, and The Company. His contribution to the advancement of ice dancing includes concert pieces for numerous Olympic skaters, and we're going to see as our third clip, a clip from The Planets, which was an ice dance that Lar choreographed. He has been a choreographer on Broadway, and the work he has done on Broadway includes Into the Woods, for which he won a Tony nomination, The Red Shoes, and the Tony Award-winning revival of The King and I. In 1987, he conceived Dancing for Life, which took place at Lincoln Center's New York State Theater. It was the first response by the dance community to the AIDS crisis, and it raised over $1 million. In 2007, Lar founded the Chicago Dancing Festival, which for 10 seasons provided free performances by leading American dance companies, and over 18,000 people went to the performances annually. In 2016, Lar premiered a new evening-length ballet, The Bronze Horseman, in St. Petersburg, Russia. In 2014, he was appointed as Distinguished Professor of Dance at the University of California, Irvine, where he continues to teach. Even in these pandemic times, he has been teaching by video, much as we're going to be talking today. Lar's awards include being a Ford Fellow in 2011, receiving the Dance USA Honors Award in 2012. I could go on and on, but since we are lucky enough to have Lar with us, with this, I would like to say hello and welcome to you, Lar. Thank you so much for being here. So I want to start us off with a question, which I think will be a good introduction to our time together. And that is, how did you realize that you were so interested in dance and choreography, and what did you do to further your interests? Lar, are you with us?
Hi, Beth. It looks like we lost him for a second, so we are going to give him a minute to see if he can reconnect.
Okay. Yeah, he seemed like he was frozen. Well, sorry, everyone. I hope you'll be patient with our technical difficulty here. Well, if Lar is not able to reconnect shortly, maybe we should proceed with the first clip while we try to work out our technical difficulties. The first clip is from the full-length ballet Othello, and we're having a duet theme today. All three of the clips are duets, and Lar was going to set this up, but it's the last duet in Othello. It is a duet between Desdemona and Othello. And what do you think, Farrell? Should we start with the clip?
Yeah, great.
When we get Lar back, he can tell us more about the clip. But
thank you.
Well, I am seeing myself in the box next to myself, which is unfortunate because that's where Lar was supposed to be. Carol, have you had any luck getting Lar back?
No, unfortunately, he hasn't responded. I reached out to him via email and was hoping he could maybe join us by phone, but he hasn't been able to do that yet. I know there are storms going through the area, so.
Yeah. Well, in the meantime, I will do what I can. Lar didn't want me to ask him the questions ahead of time because he wanted everything to be fresh and unrehearsed. So I don't have many of his answers, but I do have one that's relevant to what we just saw. Obviously, Othello is, to say the least, a very well-known story. And I had asked Lar if when he choreographs, he has a story in mind and he decides to choreograph to go with the story, or if he has dance movements in mind and he thinks that those movements fit a particular story. And his answer, I thought, was just wonderful. He said, I think of a story that can be told in pictures, and that story is the story I decide to choreograph to. So that is how he decided to use Othello. And as I said at the opening of our webinar, that is a full-length ballet in three acts. It was performed at Lincoln Center by ABT. It was also performed in San Francisco by the San Francisco Ballet, and it's been performed throughout the country. So what I especially love about Lar's dance is how lyrical it is, and that it has a lot of elements of traditional dance, but also a very modern sensibility. And for over 25 years, I've been watching Lar's dancing, and it literally gives me chills every time. So I'm happy to have been able to share that with you, and I'm very disappointed. We worked very hard with a lot of rehearsals for this webinar, and I'm very disappointed that Lar is not here, but I hope he'll be able to phone in. I don't know if people have submitted questions as to that piece. Obviously, I cannot really answer them, but we can collect them for Lar if and when he's able to join us. I think in the absence of Lar joining us, we'll go to the next clip, which is from Concerto 622, which is named after the Kerschel number of a Mozart concerto. And that dance is also a duet, as was what we just saw, and it is a two-man duet. And I think Lar was one of the first, if not the first, choreographer to do a lot of work with two men. That dance was created around the time that the AIDS crisis began, and it was used to raise a lot of awareness and, as I said, to raise a lot of funds for the AIDS crisis. It raised over $1 million. So why don't we go to that clip next? Carol, are we able to bring up that clip?
Thank you.
Well, that was beautiful. That's one of my favorite of all Lar's dances. And I think we just have to try to laugh and chalk this up to trying to entertain and do an interview in pandemic times. And the ironic thing is that Lar traveled all the way into New York City today from his home in upstate New York because he was afraid that the storms would knock out his service in upstate New York. And so, oh, I think we have Lar on the phone now, I've been told, which is great. Lar, are you there?
I am on the phone, Beth. Do you think that you and everybody else can hear me all right?
I can hear you, and I'm very happy to hear your voice because I was afraid I was going to run out of things to say. So we've watched the duet from Othello, and we've also watched the duet from Concerto 622. So I know that you have things that you wanted to say to set up the clips. We've already seen them, but maybe there are some things you'd like to say that will inform people's viewing of them, even though it will be after the viewing. And then we do have questions for you.
All right. I will do my best after the fact. And so sorry that we're running into this technical difficulty. But this is our lives today on the internet go exactly this way. So
exactly.
I did want to say that the pieces that we've chosen to look at today are all duets. And one of the reasons is because I find that ensemble or group dancing on video, and particularly over a small screen internet, just has no impact at all. I know I've tried to watch a good deal of dance, and I've been disappointed at all my experiences with looking at ensemble work, but I feel like the personal aspect of two people dancing and the close-up nature of duets has more impact. So we're really looking at just duets today, though the majority of my work has been large ensemble pieces. So the Othello duet, and by the way, those are principal dancers of the Joffrey Ballet in Chicago.
That's a question. What are the names of dancers? Can you tell us who they are?
Yeah, that's Fabrice Calmel and Victoria Gianni. He happens to be originally from France, and Victoria is from Russia, actually Georgia. And they've been to the Joffrey Ballet for some time, and the Joffrey Ballet has done Othello many times. And I consider them two of the leading exponents of that particular dance. So it is the final duet of the entire story. And anyone familiar with the story knows that this is the moment at which Othello exacts his revenge for what he believes, mistakenly, to be Desdemona's unfaithfulness. And in my version, I've chosen to use the famous handkerchief as the instrument of her destruction. At the beginning of the dance, he presents it to her as an object of his worship of her, and it's a very magical handkerchief. In the story, we're led to understand that it was woven from the silk of Egyptian mummies. Egyptian virgin mummies, in fact, was presented down many generations of his family, and finally to his mother, and finally to him. But it bears the legend or the curse that it ensures faithfulness of the spouse, but woe be he whose spouse is unfaithful. And in this particular story, he believes she is, and this instrument of worship becomes her instrument of destruction. Sadly, difficult way to start a dance program, pretty heavy, but that's the story. The second duet.
Can you tell us about that and where that fits in time? I had set the framework for it a bit, saying that that was a performance that raised money for AIDS and that you were one of the first, if not the first, choreographers to choreograph with two men doing a duet. But I'm sure you can add much more than what I said about the time and place when you created that and what led you to create that dance?
Well, I think that that's a very pertinent question. And it was something that I organized. It was the first response to the AIDS crisis from any theater community. And it seemed to me at that moment that we all had to pay attention and speak out loud about what was going on. So many young dancers were being lost. But one of the themes that emerged at that time that I thought was significant and worth commenting on was friendship. And sad to say that many friends were helping friends to die. And we witnessed a great deal of courage at that time. And the duet for two men is a duet about friendship, really. Some people mistakenly think and thought at that time that if two men dance together or touch each other in any way, that it's intended as something homoerotic or can be read that way, but not at all. There was no intention of that at all. This is the same love that two men at war feel when they do battle together and count on each other's loyalty and ability to save each other's lives. And this is the kind of depth of friendship I was witnessing at the time and that I wanted to comment on with this duet. And the duet subsequently became almost a signature piece of the AIDS crisis and appeared at many, many fundraisers and benefits. And I'm very proud to say that a dance, which some people think it was only decorative, could be put to real use at a time of need.
Yes, that is wonderful. And I think that leads us into a discussion that I was going to save for the end, but I think you've set the stage for it perfectly about, especially now during a pandemic and with everything that's going on in the world, how important the arts are to our society. I mean, they're the heart of a culture. And I know from having been on the board of the Lar Lubovitch Dance Company for all of this time that it's always a struggle for the arts to keep going, even a company as well-known as yours. And I think it's really quite miraculous that you've been able to keep this company going for as long as you have. Where do you see the arts going at this time? And what do you want your place in it to be? I just think that's such an important topic for us all to focus on, especially now.
Well, that's a very, very big question and probably requires an essay-length answer, but I will try to capture it in as few words as possible. You know, we all are subject to illnesses of the body, and we endeavor to cure those illnesses with science and medicine. And there is also, at the same time, illness of the spirit. And illness of the spirit can make life intolerable also. And we're seeing a good deal of that right now. I've never been comfortable when I hear art described as an escape from reality, some people like to say. I actually think it's the opposite. I think it's an entree to a higher reality, where idealism and integrity are the common denominators instead of that other thing we mistakenly call reality, whose low watermarks sometimes are cruelty and unkindness and greed. And we're seeing a demonstration of that right now, and that would appear to be a level of reality. But there's this other level of reality that art speaks to, of these higher ideas of what humanity is in possession of. And when those illnesses of the spirit occur, it's inspiration that's required, and inspiration is what art is made of.
Yes, I think that's just a wonderful answer. Thank you. We do have some questions that have come in while we've been speaking, and some questions that people sent in ahead of time. I'm mindful of the time because we do have one more clip and I don't want to run out of time for that. But let me ask you the question I started with before we lost you, which was, you've had such a prolific career and it's lasted over so many years, but I'm very interested in the starting point, and I imagine the other people listening are as well. How did you know that this was what you wanted to do, and what did you do to get started in dance and choreographing?
I think that I have to sort of lean on a cliche here and say I was simply born to dance, as strange or possibly even arrogant as it may sound, but I began dancing. I began dancing as soon as I could walk. As a child, dancing was a response to almost anything that happened in my life, just sort of spontaneous improvisation dancing. And at a very early age, I lived in a house which was across the street from a department store. It was a two-floor department store. I was about 3 or 4 years old, and it was in Chicago in the dead of winter. And our second floor windows, faced the second floor windows of this store. And one night there was an enormous fire, and the store went totally up in flames, and fire engines rushed and doused it with water all night. And in the morning when I woke up, I looked out my window, and cascades of frozen ice were coming out of the second floor windows. And the frozen cascades of ice were filled with toys and lipsticks and spoons and shiny objects. And I don't know why, but I went into a wild, crazy dance. And it was somehow the only way I could express what I felt about this kind of magical, awesome thing I was seeing. So dance has always been a very powerful element of my particular spirit. Now, I didn't discover there was a profession until I was in college, curiously enough. And it was at college that I saw a dance company for the first time. Happened to have been a modern dance company, the Jose Limon Company. And I recognized instantly that that was what I was meant to do. I immediately left college, moved to New York, auditioned for the Juilliard School, although I had never danced before. I choreographed a dance for the audition, and I was allowed into the school, and that was the beginning of my life as a dancer.
Wow, so you really were born to dance. That is quite amazing. I don't know how I didn't even know that story until now. But you learn something new all the time. Can you tell us a little bit about your process of choreographing? While you were not on the phone, I told our audience the question I had asked you, the one question I had asked about, do you decide to create a dance and then fit it to a story, or do you decide on the story? And that you said you think of a story that can be told in pictures, but do all of your dances tell stories, or are some more like what you just said, movements to go with amazing things you're seeing or feeling?
Well, in fact, I've not done many actual narrative story dances. Othello was a big one, and that really was a story. But what I really do is I try to make a painting of the music, a painting in time and space. And really, I'm telling the story of the music. And it can be a very abstract story, a story of energy and dynamics and shape and space. And sometimes it can tell a story that's more specific, like the story of Othello, or in this case, the story that underlies the duet for the two men. But more often than not, and almost always, I start with music. I study the music very intensely. And by the time I go in the studio with the dancers, I can just about sing the music. And then I begin to make a dance to it. And my effort is to, as I like to say, paint a picture of the music.
Mm-hmm. Someone has written in a question asking, can you describe your process of choreographing, partnering, and lifts?
Well, I like to think I was a very good partner as a dancer, and I enjoy partnering and I enjoy choreographing duets because there's a specific skill in partnering, and I like to describe it as becoming one thing instead of two. And the man, if it's a male-female duet, for instance, which more often than not it is, has to become an extension of the woman. So that whatever she does, he's extending the lines, the shape, the dynamic, the energy that she's using, and they become one thing instead of two. And when a duet is working very, very well, I think that most people do not see them as separate entities, but see them as something happening all at once. I would like to point out also that of the thousands and thousands of dances that have been created in this last century and more, the pivot moment of almost every one of those dances, and this is, say, a majority of those dances, is a duet. That's the moment where everything has led to this moment where the two lead dancers come together to express the most personal and the most vivid aspect of what the entire dance is coming to say. It's like a summary of everything that's been accumulating. Mm-hmm. And you'll see in almost every dance that you witness of this kind that it's this moment of two people coming together, that becomes the pivotal moment that embodies the real essence of the dance.
Well, I think that's a really good segue to our last clip, which is an unusual kind of duet. It's ice dancing, and it's from a work called The Planets, and I'll let you set it up more, Lar, before we see the clip.
Yes, I had the good fortune to do quite a good amount of ice dance choreography, and it was at a time when the skill of ice dancing was being expanded into a more artistic endeavor that was largely headed by John Curry, who was the Olympic gold medalist in 1976. And he formed an ice dance company that, for those of you who might remember, if you were of an age and able to go to dance at that time, his company performed at the Metropolitan Opera House in New York City. They froze the entire stage. And he found me. He saw my work and thought it would really work for ice skaters. He thought there was a quality of flow that he thought would be appropriate for the ice. So I began several years of choreographing a lot of major ice dance work. And this particular piece was a dance made for film to Gustav Holst's music, The Planets. It had seven parts, and each part was a portrait of a particular mythic god from Grecian times for whom the planets were named. In this duet, it's a duet which is most unusual because it's for an ice dancer, a man, and he's partnering a ballet dancer who is not on ice skates. She's in ballet shoes. He is Paul Duchesne. Yeah. He was a silver medal winner at the Olympics in ice dance. And his partner was a principal dancer of National Ballet of Canada, whose name is Sophie, and I regret to say I can't remember her last name, much to my embarrassment. But this is she is Venus in this case, and it's a love duet because Venus is a goddess of love. And once again, she's on ballet shoes and he's on ice skates. So there you go. This is Venus from The Planet.
Very unusual. Okay, thank you, Lar. So if we could see that, that would be great. Thanks. That was beautiful and so unusual with one of the duo on skates and one not on skates. That was great. So we've been asked if we'll continue for a few more minutes because we lost some of the time. Is that okay with you, Lar? Do you have the time?
Absolutely.
Okay, well, I hope our audience has a little bit of time too. I'm gonna go to some of the questions. One I think is interesting. Well, they're all interesting, but what inspired you about some of your earliest teachers? For example, Jose Limon, Martha Graham, Pearl Lang, et cetera. Is there anyone who was a particular inspiration or well, did you drive inspiration from all?
I did have the good fortune of having the first teachers I ever met, and really the first dancing I ever did was in the classes of Martha Graham and Jose Limon and Alvin Ailey. Those were the three first teachers that I had, and I think that I was inspired by their passion. It was just they were so devoted to this wonderful thing that I discovered was my sort of the center of myself, and inspired by their depth of passion and commitment. And that was a generation of people who made profound pronouncements. We don't see that much anymore, the great speakers who can sum things up in words so succinctly and so beautifully that one is altered by what they say. And all three of those people had that ability. And I think that sort of set the tone for what I would be pursuing.
Well, that was a wonderful opportunity. Someone has asked you, talk about dance being the visualization of music, which we just discussed a bit. Do you start creating the new work to the piece of music always, or do you sometimes start with the movement or concept?
I always start with the music.
Okay.
It really is the ground that I stand on. Without music, I don't think that my mind's eye would see anything. But the music causes an inner visualization, and I begin to see the music in my own mind's eye, and then my endeavor is to make what I see visible. But it's always music first for me.
But you do have experience as a visual artist as well, by which I mean more traditional, not dance as visual art, but actual painting and drawing. How has that influenced your dance?
Well, this is you know, not a paradox, but a kind of a matching of opposites that makes sense together. Before I had seen real dance and realized that there was a world of dance to join, I had been an art major at college, and I had been painting and drawing and sculpting from the time that I was very young. And when I saw dance and choreography, oh, I have to add to that I had been a competing gymnast also on the college level. And then when I saw this dance company for the first time, it was the two things I did best and loved most all put together. So this sense of painting carried right over into the gymnastics of dance, where I sort of, that's why I describe my dances as paintings of the music rather than even music visualization, because I feel that I'm using painting technique to address the time and the space.
And here's another question from our audience. If you could have worked with one composer or one dancer with whom you did not work, which person would that be and why? I'm not sure if you've ever given that a thought. It's a big question, too.
Well, I don't know that there can be an answer to that question. If I could be in a room with Mozart and dance as he composed in that moment, that would be an amazing fantasy.
Yeah. I would like to be able to see that, Lar. That would be incredible.
You know, Mozart wrote a lot of dance music. It was one of his favorite things to do. And he loved to go to parties. And when he had a party to go to, he'd spend the whole day writing dance music for everyone at the party to dance to. So he had a real affinity. He had a real affinity for movement. And when I hear his music, I feel that affinity for dance that is in the sort of infectious shape of his music.
Yeah. Which of your many works are you most proud of and why?
I don't know that I can pick out a single dance, but I will say for the reason of the role that it played in the real life we were living, that Concerto 622 holds a special place in my heart because it is an opportunity for dance to really have meaning, obvious meaning for everyone concerned. Dance is a very, very beautiful thing. There's unbelievable depth available for those who can see it, but it doesn't often take a role in affecting society at the moment of need. And that duet, I'm proud to say, of the 120 or so dances that I made really served a purpose, and so far beyond abstraction, so far beyond entertainment, so far beyond decoration. And for that reason, I do hold a special fondness for that duet.
Yeah, I suspected that would be your answer to that question. Another question is, which choreographers today do you follow and watch, and what do you like about their work?
Well, there are some very talented people working at this time. I can easily name Mark Morris as one of the best choreographers we have working today. I think he's really special, and he was a dancer in my company for 3 years. And when I see his work, I'm very pleased to see my influence in there. And and his work has elevated dance quite a bit. Another sort of amazing creator is William Forsythe, whose work has been mostly done in Europe but is well known in America. And there are a lot of talented choreographers around, and what one likes in dance is almost always a very specific kind of taste. Just because something is lauded, praised, celebrated, doesn't necessarily mean that one can see it and receive it in the way that others have. It takes seeing a lot of dance to see that special dance, a special choreographer that speaks to you. And for me, I've always looked back to choreographers rather than forward. I go to see everything, but when I need to be inspired, I go to see Balanchine.
Well, I think we have time for one more question, and this is a good one to end with, I think, which is, do you have any advice to young dancers right now?
Well, right now, in this moment of time,
right during the pandemic, but I guess more in these times of recent years, which I think ties together with the difficulty for fundraising for the arts.
Yes, a dancer who is going to dance, they know that, and nothing will stop them. And for those young people who are dreaming of being a dancer, I would say that you should not allow anybody's version of reality to take you off of that path. It's a very difficult thing to do, but with imagination and dedication and knowing who you are, for those young dancers who know they really are dancers, they really can't be stopped anyway. They will go ahead no matter what.
Well, thank you so much for being here, Lauren, for making the best of a bad technical situation. I know this was very challenging, and we really appreciate your being here. And we appreciate everyone who signed on for being here. And if you'd like to learn more about the Lar Lubovitch Dance Company, we will be following up, and there'll be a link that you can click on to learn more about the company. I do urge you to support the arts, especially in these difficult times. So thank you so much for being with us. And Lar, thank you. It was a great pleasure to have you here with us. Have a good night, everyone.
Yes, thank you all for tuning in. I hope that I hope you were able to hear me. Thank you, Beth.
Yes, for sure. And your answers were fascinating. So I think you were right about not rehearsing ahead of time. It was much better to just do it live and hear everything fresh. So thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Beth. Bye-bye.
Bye.